Okay, so welcome everyone. Today's guest is Thorsten Altekirk from the University of Nottingham. He will be talking about the integers in HOT. So please, Thorsten.
Okay, yes. So thank you, first of all, for inviting me. I always like to come to Tallinn. maybe we can go out for dinner or for a beer. No, I guess not. It's obviously a bit of a shame, but anyway, I'm still happy to be virtually somewhere. Let me do a little test first of all. How much do people know about HOT? About HOT means homotopy type theory, by the way. Can we see? Maybe can we have a? Is there a vote mechanism here, sort of? Okay, can people say something? I mean, I hope that there are some people who don't know everything about HOT, because well, I was I, going...
Yeah. Also, I know a little bit about HOT.
That's good. Some other people? I mean, Nikolai knows a lot about HOT, and Tarmo knows a lot about HOT. Bernhard as well. Ed knows a lot about HOT. Who's there? There are some... All the people, okay. It doesn't say me the name. Okay, that's a bit annoying. How do I find out the name of people? I can't. Okay. So. There's Robin. 5 to 6 years. Okay, that's first chapters of the hot book. These are the best chapters because some of them were written by me. Very good. Preface. Oh, that's the most. I was suggesting we start the numbering of the chapters with -2, but then it wasn't accepted. So preface should be -2. But anyway, this is an insider joke, I guess. So I was going to talk a bit about HOT and hope it's also interesting for the people who already know a lot. So zero. This is my favorite topic, or not my favorite, one of my favorite types versus sets. Okay. Let me just use a standard example, which is overused, but I really want to. I think it's a good one. So let's see. We have got a structure, like a semi-ring. So the natural numbers. With plus, zero, times, and one, and all the laws of a semi-ring. The laws are not really very important. So the natural numbers here are defined a la piano, yeah? So there's zero is a natural number, and successor is this operation, right? So that's one structure. Now we have another structure, the natural numbers, but in binary, right? And we do plus in binary and zero in binary and times in binary and one in binary and so on, okay? So these two structures, how do I call them? This is n bar p, and here's n two bar, this is, okay? So we have these two structures, which are both semi-rings, and I'm not really bothered to define exactly what a semi-ring is. But here's my point. These two structures are isomorphic, right? So you can define functions in both directions, translations, let's call them f and g or something, which preserve all the structure. And actually, whatever operation or whatever you prove about one of them holds also for the other one. So there's a really, whatever you do with one, you can do with the others, with the other. So at least, okay, and here's the point. At least in type theory, that's actually true. But it's not true in set theory, right? Why not? So what is an example of a property which we can formulate in set theory, which is not preserved by this isomorphism? No. Well, what about we ask something about an element of N? So is the empty set an element of N of the carrier? That's true maybe for piano, but may not be true for the binary representation, depending what we choose. Yeah. So we can ask stupid questions in set theory. We cannot actually distinguish functions because functions are extensional in set theory, but we can ask functions, we can ask intentional questions about sets, right? And in type theory, we can't. And why is this? The fundamental difference between type theory and set theory, and now I'm not talking specifically about HOTS, but type theory in general, is that in type theory, we cannot talk about elements in isolation. Yeah, so we cannot if we have here this set N or this type N, we can only talk about it via this interface which is given to us. Yeah, and we can make statements like, for example, that X plus Y equals X plus Z implies y equals that, or something like this. Okay. But we cannot make statements about the elements of these sets, right? Because in type theory, an element can only be is always associated to its type. Yeah. If I talk of an element of the natural numbers, then that is just an element of the natural numbers. I have to tell first what the type is. In set theory, if I say X an element of N, then X could be anything. Yeah, it's not related to its set. It belongs to it, can also belong to other sets. So I can talk about elements in isolation to the types I belong to. And in a way, in set theory, the elements are first, and then we form the sets. Whereas in type theory, the elements and the types always come together, and we can only talk about elements with respect to the types. And I think actually this is good mathematical practice, because if we talk about some mathematical objects, we should always refer to what things we are talking about. Whereas in set theory, we say for all X, yeah, if X is a natural number, then something holds, right? So this means we really quantify over all sets, which is not really what we intuitively would think if you talk about natural numbers. It's not like for all things which turn out to be natural numbers, something holds, right? So that's a bit of a strange thing. So I should say in defense of set theory, when it was invented or when it was created, it was certainly a big step forward, but that is a while ago. And now I think we know better how to talk about mathematical constructions. And so that's, in my view, that's type theory. So in type theory, we cannot ask questions about the representations. And hence, anything which you can do with one of these two types, you can do with the other, and vice versa. And you cannot write down a property which distinguishes them. And this is called all property we can express are structural. Yeah? And really, the structural properties are the ones we want to talk about. We don't want to talk about representation-specific properties when we do mathematics. And yeah, so this is a property. This is not specific to hot now. This is a property which holds in type theory in general, that everything you can do is structural. You cannot write down properties of representations, unlike in set theory where you can do this. Now, is this clear? I hope my point. So once we accept this, then there is a Leibniz idea of what is this equality of indiscernibles? I think it's called, okay. I don't know how to write indiscernibles, something like this. Yeah. So basically, what's the idea? If we have two mathematical objects and everything we can say about it is the same, then these are the same object. I mean, a mathematical object is given by what we can do with it. It's not given by the way it's defined. Yeah? It's what we can do with, what we can see about it. You know, definition shouldn't matter, but only what we can see about a mathematical object, what we can say about it. So two mathematical objects which share the same properties should be equal. And hence, these two, for example, as I've just explained, there's nothing we can do to distinguish them. They should be the same. That's a fundamental idea. These two structures, we cannot distinguish them. Hence, they should be equal. That's just following Leibniz and Vygotsky, obviously. So univalence is basically a way to implement this. And univalence implies, and this is what's called the structural equivalence principle, which I was going to say earlier, isomorphic structures are equal. Yeah? And this is morally, was formulated by Vygotsky, and it's morally a consequence of this idea, right? Okay. Are you with me so far? I'm always difficult in these online talks to discern. It's not what we are underneath, but what we do that defines us. That's a good, nice quote. Yeah, thank you very much. In this case, what can be done to us? If you're a mathematical object, then you're an object and not a subject. But I appreciate the quote, it's very nice. Okay, so let's move on. And I want to do a little bit more background. And I want to, because it's actually useful for my talk, so I actually need it, but it fits in very well. Univalence, I want to talk about univalence and equivalence. And it's a little bit technical. Sorry, the first one was a bit philosophical. Now I'm going to be a little bit more technical. I know that some people like this. Tamo looks a bit bored, so I shouldn't do too much philosophy at him, I guess. So hopefully. But this is stuff he already knows, right? Yeah, exactly. So that was my thought, Ed. Thank you. Did we actually record?
Yes, we are recording now.
Oh, we are recording, okay. So what's the next thing I want to say? Okay, so often univalence, in univalence, we don't need to formulate, to get the system, we don't need to talk about structures, it's enough to talk about types. And often univalence is summarized as this property, as to say, if there are two types, so A and B are types, okay? If A is isomorphic to B, well, what do I mean by A isomorphic to B? Okay, let me just write this down. So A isomorphic to B, okay, I just write as a structure, which is a sigma type, is a function from A to B, right? The function from B to A. Okay, and the composition is always identity. Or let's say, how do I call this? FG is for all X and A. I was the wrong way around, right? G of F of X is equal to X. Well, this could be called GF, and FG is for all Y and B. FG of Y equal Y. Sorry, I need this later, so I'm going too much into detail. I mean, obviously, it's much nicer to draw a little diagram. But then, okay, then it's not clear what commutes, right? So you can actually draw a diagram which expresses this, but it's a bit complicated with triangles and stuff. Anyway, so I guess everybody knows what an isomorphism is. So say A and B are isomorphic. Sorry to be. And we can also say that these three express that F is an iso, right? So that is this part of the structure is just saying that F is an iso. So now, often, let me leave some space. Oh, do I copy it later? Okay, maybe I copy it. But I'm always bad with copying. This is really difficult. So often, univalence is expressed as equivalent types are equal. Right? And this is a corollary. Actually, it's a corollary of univalence. But often, if you want to just give a basic idea, we write down this. But let's get a bit more into detail. And let's observe that if we have types which are equal, so by the way, here's an implicit quantification. If I write AB, if you know actor variable AB colon type, okay? So I'm assuming that this is always quantified. If A is equal to B, then A is isomorphic to B, is actually a function, right? Let's call it E to I, okay? And this one we can define in type theory, because all we need to do is to prove that A is isomorphic to A, yeah? And that's enough to prove this. And now we could say this function actually should be an isomorphism. We want actually to have an isomorphism between equality and isomorphism. So what about this? UA is iso E to I. Is this okay? Now I need the experts. Is this a good way to UA stands for univalence axiom, which isn't really an axiom, but we'll come to it in a second. But I call it principle, but okay. So this one we can define, and now we say this is an isomorphism. Is this a good way to define univalence?
No, apparently. It's not well behaved.
Yeah, but why is it not well behaved? I mean, what does well behaved mean? I'm not well behaved, so I mean. Is there a problem with this? Yeah, it's very badly behaved because it's inconsistent. So you can do prove false. You can prove false, okay? It's bad.
Are you sure about that?
Yeah, we went through this. I can tell you why. Because if you have this, equivalence and isomorphism are isomorphic, which is not true. I mean, you can have a context.
No, I think that was a slightly different thing. So, I mean, this statement is a consequence of the real univalence. So it it's certainly not inconsistent.
No, but it follows also from the wrong univariant. Okay, but can we take it off?
Okay, sure.
I claim it's inconsistent, but I need to accept this. So why is it, let's say, badly behaved, first of all? So one of the problem here is, once we have this principle, then we know that equality is no longer what we call a proposition. What's a proposition? Proposition is a type which has most one inhabitant. So, I mean, this is prop of A just says that all elements of A are equal. Okay. So that's the idea of a proposition is that it's a type which has no information apart from its inhabitants. And actually, if we say we write prop for a type which is a proposition for the type of types, which are propositions, and this is actually a subob in hot. So okay, once I've done hot, it turns out to be a subobject classifier. Actually, I don't need univalence. No, I do need some univalence. Actually, that's not okay. So once I have the proper formulation of univalence, it turns out to be a subobject classifier in the sense of topos theory. So what do I want to say? So the problem is that this thing here, oh no, that equality is not a proposition. How can we see that equality is not a proposition? We know that bool equals bool is isomorphic to bool is isomorphic to bool, and there are two ways, two isomorphisms on bool, which are identity and negation. So bool equals bool has more than one element, so it's not a proposition. And once this is not a proposition, then isof is not a proposition. Yes, there is a unique inverse, but there may be different ways of proving this. So that's not a proposition. Okay. So how can we fix this? Actually, there are several ways to fix this. So the standard way is to define instead what is called equivalence. And what's an equivalence? So there are different ways to formulate it, but one of them is to add an extra property for these equalities. Namely, if you want to prove that f of x is equal to f of x, then there are two ways of doing this. You can either do it with fg, or you do it with gf, and this coherence law, it's called Koch, just states that these two things are the same. So that, what is this? That fg applied to f of x is the same as gf of x, and now we have to apply f to the equality proofs, okay? So the coherence says that these proofs are the same. Now, whenever you see this, you should wonder directly, immediately about one issue, namely, you could also formulate, I'm not in a very good space situation here, you could also, instead of the Koch I have, maybe I get rid of a bit here, something, where is it? Can I not? Okay. Let me get rid of this thing here. Okay. We could also do the opposite, right? We can g of y equals g of y, what is a g and a y, would be an alternative way to formulate this extra property, right? And if you think about it, these two properties, if you have all of them, if you know a little bit of category theory, then you know that this is actually the formulation of an adjunction. Yeah? So what I have here is a half adjunction, because we have only one of these laws, only one of the triangle laws, and not the other. But the point is, the interesting exercise is that if you have this is not an arbitrary adjunction; it's an adjunction over a category which has inverses, so it's a groupoid. And in a category with groupoid, you can derive one triangle law from the other. So it's not necessary to state the other law, because it's provable. It's obvious enough to only state one. I mean, you have a choice which one you state, but it doesn't really matter. But you shouldn't state both, because once you state both, then you need to make them coherent again, and you have to add more coherence properties, right? So that's one way. This is called the half adjoint definition of equivalence. So it's basically what you know is isomorphism from sets, and then this coherence properties about these equality properties, which is, as I say, it's one of the triangle laws, if you know category theory, one of the triangle laws of an adjunction. Yes, it's actually interesting, because you may wonder, why is isomorphism not the right notion here? But actually, it's not the right notion of isomorphism, because what we've written down as isomorphism is what's called isomorphism of sets. And we can also say, what is a set? A set is a type that all equalities are propositions. And for those, this is the correct version of isomorphism. As if I say A and B are sets, I have not defined what a set is. A set, not in the sense of set theory, but a set in the sense of hot, is something where all equalities, so for all x, y in A, is prop of x equals y. So all, this is like what we usually think about an equality. It's a proposition. And if you have a propositional equality, if A and B are sets, then this is the correct definition, and that's okay. And for sets, this statement here is also unproblematic. I mean, the wrong version of univalence for sets is completely okay. But for types in general, we need to say something about the equalities, the higher equalities, because they're not all trivial. And if one does this naively, one would add infinitely many equalities. It turns out it's enough to add this one. But there's a co-inductive definition, actually, of equivalence, which does this infinitely, and which is sort of, if you think naively, which is sort of more natural. Okay. There's another, there's another formulation of equivalence. So let me just say, given a function f, it's an equivalence. So it's equivalence of f. We can also say, if it has a left adjoint and a right adjoint, so if there is a function, so g composed with f is the identity, and another function f composed with h is the identity. So they are functioned, what am I call left, L and R? Sorry, just changed my mind. So I function L and R from B to A, which have these properties, left inverse and right inverse. And that is actually okay. That is a proposition, and that's a bit surprising. But that's often the case. If you do something more, if you give more freedom, you get more coherence. But anyway, so I'm writing A is a is an equivalence to B, that's this equivalence, which is really isomorphism of types, but we don't want to confuse people. It's a function from A to B, which is an equivalence. Okay, so so this one here, these three properties are called is equivalence. Okay. Okay. Let me. What? And the univalence. So the correct statement of univalence. So first of all, there is a function from equality to equivalence, which says if A is equal to B, then A is equivalent to B. And UA says that this is an equivalence of E to E. Okay. Oh, yes. So I said something about univalence axiom. So that's, is this an axiom? So if you look at the hot book, it's added as an extra constant to type theory. But that's not in the spirit of type theory, because in type theory, we don't really add axioms. We always add constructions which can be reduced, which can be reduced to something else. And this issue, the computational behavior of univalence, has been addressed by Thierry Coucon and lots of other people in this cubical type theory. Cubical type theory is really, in a way, a proper implementation of Hott. And there is a system called cubical acta, which is just a sort of an extra flag when you run acta programs, which implements this, and which is really very nice, I think, implementation of homotopy type theory. And in this system in particular, you can prove univalence, and you can also prove a number of other things. So it has got a very nice way to deal with inductive and co-inductive definition, and a very nice symmetry of what I've been talking before. Okay, but I see some people are maybe falling asleep or have switched off their camera. I don't know exactly what this means, or they do naughty things in their behind their screen or something. I don't know. Well, why is everybody switched off their camera? Is it getting boring? Was it like too much repetition? I'm now a bit worried. Maybe it was just boring. Oh, there are some people still. Ah, Otamo is still here. Okay. Was just somebody up there?
No, we haven't switched off our cameras.
Are there any questions, remark about this in the moment?
I think Zoom sometimes doesn't show it anymore to you to save bandwidth or something.
Bandwidth, okay. So are you okay? I guess most people have seen this part of the story already. I mean, so any comments, questions, remarks at this point?
I suppose I can ask a question to keep this alive. So yeah. when was it decided that the terminology is equivalence?
I don't know. Oh yeah, I can't answer this question. It should be isomorphism, right? But the confusion is that usually people associate set-level isomorphism with isomorphism, and this is isomorphism of types. I think in homotopy theory, it's called weak equivalence, but then everything is weak, so Tamo's higher up. Oh yeah. So everything is weak, so weak equivalence is a bit unnecessary, so we drop the weak, but I don't know when. But,
I think it was Vygotsky who called it weak equivalence, no?
Yes, from the homotopy view. By the way, I should say something. I would also drop the, in Hott, yeah? I would drop the homotopy bit, yeah? I would just call it type theory. I mean, what we call hot is, I mean, is the proper formulation of type theory. What was there before is maybe interesting for historic reason, but shouldn't have any relevance. So type theory, modern type theory is hot, yeah? Because a type theory which hasn't got this lightness property, is just bullshit, basically. I mean, as the foundation of mathematics, you want the two objects which are indiscernible should be equal. That's a basic principle. If it's not satisfied, then, I mean, forget about it, okay? So I call hot just type theory, okay? Yeah. Okay. I can also make some more statements like this. So let's come to the integers. Define that, okay? So here's a question. How would you define the integers? Yes. So how would you define the integers? Do you know the integers? I mean, in primary school, you learn about the natural numbers, right? And then maybe you never have to come across the integers until you open a bank account. And once you open a bank account, you realize that there are these funny numbers with a funny sign in front, and you more spend, the higher your bank account goes. And that's the point in life when you're confronted with the very existence of the integers, right? So one definition of the integers is basically exactly this, right? It's what are the integers? So we can do this in ACTA. So I call them ZNF, let's say. That's a data type. This is set, and so we have NEC, let's say, which are the negative numbers, right? Then there's zero. And that, and then there's pos, which are the positive numbers. And you can actually, there's asymmetric definitions, which are a bit, I don't like them, but you can use a Boolean to put neck pos together, and then the symmetry is nicer. So why is this not a good definition of the integers? Or why to go any further? That defines the integers, we are done, right? I finished my talk early, that's the definition of the integer. Okay. So what is wrong about this definition of the integers? I mean, nothing. I mean, it's one definition. So I would say, once you define, okay, I had a student who was doing this. And once you define the integers like this, and then you find addition and multiplication and so on. And then you start to prove something. You have to always have lots of cases, yeah. And this case analysis gets quite annoying. And I would say this definition of the integers are basically what I call them like normal forms, yeah. And you can always say, okay, I do everything with normal forms, but it's like in lambda calculus, we define application. But obviously, we can always define application only for so that we only produce normal forms. But then, if you do lambda calculus only with normal forms, it's a nuisance. I mean, you want to define something application, and you want to express laws of lambda calculus, which are not, I mean, you want reason about lambda terms, not reason about normal forms. So I would say this is the definition of the integer. Which is very low level, very much based on the notion of normal form. So I would like to have a more abstract definition. Now there are a number of them around. So one of them is, for example, a pair of natural numbers, and then you define equality. So Z is Z prime, let's say, is N times N. And then there's a quotient, which basically says that whatever, what is it? what is it? A of B is equal to CD if A plus D equals B plus C, I think, right? So that's the possible definition of the integers. And here's my favorite definition of the integers, okay? That, what do I call it? I don't know, I just call it that in the moment. And how do I define it? I start like the natural numbers. So zero is an integer, and then suck, which is written with one C, this is inherited from Connor McBride. But then we also have a predecessor. Maybe I should leave out the E. But once we have a successor and a predecessor, we need some laws, right? So I call this SP, which says for any X in Z, suck of pred of X is equal to X, right? And PS is for any X in Z, pred of the suck of X is equal to X. Now, here you have these equalities in my definition. This is an inductive definition with equalities. Now that's called a higher inductive type. I should leave some space here maybe. Okay, higher inductive type or HIT. HIT. And where do they come from? Now, in my view, if you think about HOT, a type is not just given by its elements, but a type, we also have to think about the equality and so on. So we have to think about the whole equality tower. And actually, this leads to this idea that a type is elements and elements of equalities and elements of their equalities and so on. So we have a structure which is called a weak omega groupoid. But actually, this is maybe, I find it one way for me to look at this is that in the past, we started with setoids, which are types with an equivalence relation. And they're actually a good approximation to the idea of what a set is. And then we went on, this is the groupoid interpretation of type theory, which was Hoffman and Streicher. And then we can continue this ad infinitum, and we get this idea of a weak omega groupoid as to express what equality is. But if a type is given by a weak omega groupoid, then if we inductively define such a beast, we can add not only elements on the lowest level, but also elements everywhere in the tower. And that gives rise to this idea of a higher inductive type. So it's quite natural to have this notion of inductive definitions in HOT or in type theory, as I call it. I don't have so much time. This is a very nice definition. And for example, if you define addition, you define it like you do for natural numbers, then you add the cases for the predecessor, and then it's actually quite easy to prove these extra two cases. And I would invite you to do this. Or the cubical actor, which I've mentioned before, has a very natural way to allow these sort of inductive definitions. Why do I say def? I mean data or something. And also to reason about them by using pattern matching. So that fits really, really nicely in the existing infrastructure of cubical actor. But there is a problem. Sorry, I shouldn't have, I mean, okay, let me write type here because there's this actor. I mean type, not set, okay. So if I define a type like this, this is actually not a good definition of the integers. Why not? because actually we have a coherence problem, and this is the same as we've seen before, actually, because really what we have said here is that suck is an isomorphism, right? And we know already that isomorphisms are not so well behaved, and that's also the case here, because actually, if we have suck of predecessor of successor like this, let's say of zero, that should be the same as successor of zero as one, right? But there are two ways to prove this, and that's what we have seen before, either this way or this way. So that means that these integers are not a set, because we have an equality, this inductively generated equality is not proposition. But now we know Hedberg's theorem, which is much older than Hodt, or it's older than Hodt, let's say, actually is a theorem which shows that if a set has a decidable equality, it's decidable equality, or if a type has a decidable equality, I should say, then it's a set. Okay. And what does this tell us? It tells us, by just negating it, if a type is not a set, it cannot have a decidable equality, right? And that's very strange, because now we have a definition of the integers which hasn't got a decidable equality, which is one way to see that this is not really what we think about integers, right? So we need to fix this. We have this coherence problem, and we need to fix it. So now there is the steam hammer way of fixing it. And the steam hammer way is that we just say, is set, which Billy says that it's a set. So what do we say for any two integers and for any two equalities of integers? We have P equals Q. So we add this, and then we get a correct definition of the integers. And how can we show this? Oh, we can show this, for example, by, so if you look at the Z and F and the integers, so you have certainly an embedding here. It's not difficult. And you can define a normalization function the other way, and then you can prove that they're inverses to each other, so you basically prove a normalization theorem. But there is a problem with this definition of the integers, namely exactly this constructor here. So if I want to define a function from function f, from the integers to any type x, then the problem is I have to interpret all these constructors. So I have to find a zero, a successor, a predecessor, prove this equation, prove that they're an isomorphism. But I also need to show that X is a set. And that means that I can only define functions or at least using the elimination directly, I can only define function into sets. And that's quite a limitation, because once I work with structures, I may want to mix integers and structures. And actually, one of the basic theorems is that the loop space of a higher inductive type, so the loop space, how do I have loop space again, pi 1 or something, is the same as the integers. But so I define a function here, this is a circle, from the integers to the circle, but actually at this point, I don't know yet that this thing is actually a set. So I wouldn't be allowed to do this. So if I want to mix, if I want to work with structures and the integers at the same time, then this limitation that I can only write functions from the integers to sets is a serious limitation. Okay, so let me solve this. And there's actually quite a sort of natural solution. Instead of is set, I add exactly my coherence property, which I had formulated before, right? Which is basically, what is it? That there are two ways to prove SPS of X equals S of X, that these two ways are the same, okay? So successor predecessor of successor of X equals successor of X. There are two ways to prove this using my constructors, and they are the same. This is exactly the coherence property. And so if I add, okay, if I delete this and add this coherence property, then this is actually saying that successor is an equivalence. And that we would think should do the trick, but actually it's not as easy. Because, okay, what we would think is we have in our definition of the integers, so the integers, what do I want to say? Yes, in our definition of the integers, if you think of algebras of integers, algebras of the signature, so then we would say that algebra is a sigma type of something standing for zero. Yeah, or this is a set A, let's call it Z. A successor, a predecessor, and so on, and these laws, and the coherence law. Yeah, so set to Z, and so on. And now we would think that, and this is basically saying nothing else than that S is an equivalence. And we know, okay, that this is a proposition. I've actually said, maybe I've forgotten to say this, that equivalence makes adding the coherence property turns this into an equivalence. Now, we would think maybe that sorry, I should have said something else first. So we want to basically do this proof here. And if we do this proof on the integers with this coherence property, we have to prove, in particular, we have to prove that amp followed after NF is the identity. But this is actually now becoming a little bit more difficult, because Z is now a higher inductive type, so we have to also take these higher equalities into account. And this is really getting very complicated, because we have all these higher equalities, and we have to prove that this equation holds for these higher equalities. And I have no idea how to prove this directly. However, and that's what I was just going at, we know that this thing is a proposition. So we would think maybe the following should hold if we have two Z algebras, or a morphism of Z algebras, which I haven't formulated, but it's the obvious thing. Yeah, it's a morphism on the carrier which preserves the whole structure. So if we look at Z algebra morphisms, we may think that because everything apart from this is really a proposition, that we can ignore it. So that means to prove that two Z algebra morphisms are the same, we only have to say this is a function from Z to Z prime. We only have to say that they do, have two morphisms that do the same thing on the Z, and then if you have left Z successor, so we have this diagram here to commute, and we can ignore all the complicated rest. Right. F prime. Okay. Yeah. Is this right? I'm not sure. So yes, so that would be nice. However, it turns out it's not so easy. So it's not the case. Okay, this was actually a path we investigated, or we thought about it would be a proof. If you have a structure here, and part of it is the proposition, then we can ignore the propositional part for the morphisms. And it turns out that this is not true. Okay. So I missed something. Josh said something. Yeah, I wanted it to equal. I don't want it to be a proposition, to be honest. I don't, I mean, that's not what I want to say, right? Okay, so this idea that if you have a structure where one part is a proposition, that then this is a structural notion of morphism, we can ignore. I'm running out of time, right? What is the situation? If people start dying, then it's too much, or?
No, it's great.
Okay, I think I need 10 minutes. So, So to have, yes, once we have this property that we only have to look at zero and successor, then it's actually easy to do this proof, because we only have to prove that this is the same for zero and for successor, and that's pretty straightforward, just losing the natural definition of M and NF. However, it turns out it's not true in general. And this is Paolo Capriotti, who has got, I mean, lots of input to this, I should mention, and also Nicolai. So he came up with this following counterexample, which is very easy. You just have a type with an operation, let's call it like successor, or like a binary operation, which is A arrow A arrow A. And then you add something, namely a neutral element. You add an element E in A, which is, so that E star A star X is equal to X, and X star E is equal to X. So you add the laws. Now, it's easy to see that this is a proposition, right? Because, I have some dog problem here, okay. This is a proposition because there is at most one neutral element. However, it is not true if you that any morphism, which is just defined on this part, will automatically preserve E. So if you have a morphism between these structures, so functional F from A to A prime, which preserves star, then there is no reason that it also preserves the neutral element. And that's exactly the sort of thing we need. Yeah. So a structural morphism here, which is defined in all these components, you would ask it to preserve the chosen neutral element. But if we ignore this part of the structure because it's a proposition, we cannot recover, we get morphisms which do not preserve E, right? I don't know whether that's, yeah. Exactly, sorry, thank you, that's a good point. So what we need to do is, we need to look at this particular definition and we need to show that it is actually true that this part can be ignored. It's not true in general, but it's true in this case. And how do we show this? So the basic idea is this. we define a more general definition, namely we define morphisms on equivalences. So you have an F, which is between two different types. So that's an important step, which is an equivalence. So we define the category of equivalences, and now when we define morphisms, also the natural way, I mean the structural way, expanding all this is equivalence, and then we can show that two morphisms, I mean a morphism A B and A prime B prime, here we have F and we have here these two morphisms, G and G prime, G and G prime, which preserve F, which are the same for F, are actually equal. So the G is equal. They are equal if they preserve F. So we don't need to take into account what they do on equivalences. So this is in this special case. We can ignore this propositional part of the morphism, and hence it doesn't really matter what the morphism is doing on the first part. It's only important what it's doing on the first part. It doesn't really matter what it's doing on the second part, and now we can use this result to show that because that algebra is actually this part is a particular instance of an equivalence, that we can ignore this propositional part, and we get that two morphisms which behave the same on that and successors are actually equal, which then enables us to prove the theorem. Okay. So that's the main content of this Lix paper. Actually not. I left out one issue, but now I'm running out of time. Let me very, very quickly say something else. Which is fifth formalization. And it turns out that there is an obstacle to this formalization. So the idea was to formalize this proof in cubical acta. Okay. So what we have shown is that our definition of the integers is actually a set and is equivalent to the normal form definition of the integers. Actually this is a nice definition of the integers because it interacts well with higher structures because we don't force them to be a set. We only have to prove this coherence theorem. So that's nice, and now we want to formalize it in ACTA. Now in ACTA, we define a higher inductive type is, as I said already, a higher inductive type like this one, as I say, can be defined in ACTA, and it should be very easy to prove. To do this proof, but we need one little lemma, namely that Z is the initial Z algebra. Okay, and that's usually a trivial. To prove that the natural number are the initial natural number object from induction is quite trivial. But it turns out that if you have higher constructors, it is actually quite complicated to prove, which is the reason why in the Lix paper we used a different definition of the integers, namely one which uses a bi-invertible, so Z bi-invertible map. And for the bi-invertible maps, it's still a bit of an effort to prove that this that the corresponding notion of that the hit defining it is the initial algebra in this category, because it involves filling a cube. But for the original definition, which I've given above, which has this coherence law, you actually have to fill a four-dimensional cube, which is a bit laborious. Now I should say, so the question is in general, is a higher inductive type, is a higher inductive type the initial algebra of the corresponding A algebra? And you can define in general what is an A algebra, obviously what's the initial A algebra, and that is a question. That should be true. I mean, actually, it's a conjecture. And actually, it has been, there's an unpublished proof by Christian Sattler, which shows for a very general notion of hit, actually higher inductive types, that this is the case. So I hope that this gets published sometimes, but it's not yet implemented or formalized. So it should be true, but it's not so easy because it involves higher reasoning with higher categories. Okay. Yeah, I think I better finish because unless maybe is there anybody left here? It got a bit sketchy in the end, but you can read the paper, I hope. And I have to leave out my part 6. What has this to if you want to do hot and hot? Okay, but if there's some discussion, maybe you can say something. What has it to do with hot and hot? But I think I better stop talking. I mean that the definition, the inductive type representing the natural numbers is the initial NNO. And that's trivial to prove in ACTA, right? So so what I mean is that the definition, let's say type here. So Z is a natural number and successor is NRN. That this is that N Z S is the initial N algebra. Yeah, it's a little exercise.
Yeah, which is the same as to say that this is an NNO, because to be an NNO is already a universal property. It doesn't make sense.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. No, I should have said natural number algebra. Okay, now I see what you mean. I wanted to say. Mm-hmm. So yes. So for ordinary inductive types, it's the uniqueness which is interesting. That the uniqueness, I mean, the morphism you get from the recursor, but the thing you need to prove is the uniqueness, which is a trivial consequence of induction, trivial consequence of the elimination scheme. But it turns out for higher inductive type, it is not as trivial.
Are questions allowed?
Yeah, please, not just allowed, encouraged. So I'm finished. I can say nothing more.
So actually this initiality is interesting. Is it even very clear what initiality always means in these settings?
Yes. So yes, it is clear. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Sorry.
So yes or no?
Yes, it is clear. There is a definition of, by Ambrosch Kaposi and Andras, Kovac, there is a definition using inductive type. The general definition of what is a higher inductive type, mm-hmm. and you can now define the type of algebra as an algebra morphism, and then you just it's easy to say what it means to be initial. I mean, we have to buy that this. I mean, that this is the correct definition. Of a higher inductive type, but so it can be done, and then we can define by recursion over the syntax of the definition of a high inductive type what are the algebra morphisms. I mean, it's not really a category because it's a higher category, and that's the main problem. If you would know that this is a category, that's a algebras form a normal category, then it's easy to prove, and we have done this in general. If you have quotient inductive inductive types where you force every to be a set, then it's easy to prove this. But if you give up this property that they are truncated, then you have to deal with infinity category. And I mean, there's some recent work by Nicolai where he formalizes a notion of infinity category in HOT using a two-level types theory, which is necessary to do this sort of thing. Mm-hmm.
Thanks.
Okay. Are there other questions?
Okay, I have two questions. One is, I think, hopefully short and easy, and the other one is a bit more open-ended. The short one is the coherence that you gave for the integers, the SPS is S, the two ways to show it. Does that imply that PSP is P?
Yes, it does, yeah. Yes, I mean, this is just the same proof as before, that if you have an equivalence, so you get the other triangle law for free, right?
Okay, I mean, I didn't work it out on paper while you were talking, but it sounds plausible.
Yes, wondered. So the general statement is, if you have in a group, we talk about higher groupoids, but let's ignore this for the moment. In a groupoid, in a junction of groupoids, one triangle law implies the other.
Okay, thanks. The other question is, you said something very intriguing and provocative early on that I've sort of encountered in other settings, and I was wondering if you could expand on it or add more insight into it. And that was when you said that oftentimes when you give more freedom, you get more coherence. Ah. And I think that that's a really interesting property of HOT.
It's already true if you define UIP, if you're saying, okay, uniqueness of equality proofs, right? So we could, if you say, if A and A for all P, A equals A, or for all P and Q, A equals, no, let's say for all P, sorry. P is equal to REFL, that is not provable. But if you give more freedom, we say for all A, B, and A, for all P, A equal B, no, sorry, A equals B, then we have that A comma P is equal to, what is it? B equal P is equal to A comma REFL in the type sigma x and A equals x, right? So in a way, this is already something similar, right? Where we here have a homogeneous version, and we cannot prove it, but in the moment when we give in a way more freedom, then it's actually provable. I mean, the same phenomenon, by the way, happens also here in my proof sketch. If I want to prove this directly for the integer algebras, so then I have function from A to A, right? And then I cannot prove it because I don't have enough freedom. I have to play with my B. In the moment, if I free the B, I can prove the result that the rest of the structure the propositional part of the structure doesn't influence it. So here again, I heterogenize something and give more freedom in a way by making it more heterogeneous, but then it's possible to prove. Right? So that is this instance of this general phenomenon.
Okay, somehow that seems different to me than the situation with the half adjoint equivalence, where you want like one of the coherences but not the other, and if you add the other, then you have to add another one.
Okay, no, what I meant. Sorry, I thought we were referring to the bi-invertible, right? So if I say f is an isomorphism. So I say if it's the same function, g with f is it, yeah, and f is g is it, then this is not good, right? But if I give the freedom, L of f is it, and f with r is it, so here I have one function, so one function g, b arrow a, and here I have two functions, L comma r, b arrow a, then this one is coherent, right? And this one is not coherent.
Yeah, exactly. So this is an instance of the phenomenon that I have.
Yes, that's what I meant. Mm-hmm. Yes. For the definition of equivalence, if you naively define equivalence, then you end up with a co-inductive definition, right? Which is in a way quite natural. I mean, and I would say the co-inductive definition is a definition which arises naturally from looking at types as infinity groupoids, because you have to say something for all the levels, and then it turns out that there are the shortcuts where we only have to talk about, have only finite amount of data, which obviously is more convenient.
Yeah, but somehow like the pattern or the way these shortcuts works is at least to me not intuitive yet. Like on the left version there, it's okay if you add one coherence, one level up. But if you add two coherences, now you're incoherent again and you have to add another coherence, one level up.
Yeah, because what you want is, I mean, the point is you have the derivable law, I mean, which you can just derive, and then you have the other one. So you have these two, and you would say, okay, actually, they should be the same, right?
Yeah.
But that means you add another coherence property, and by symmetry, you can add two again, so you go on forever adding coherence properties, which is okay. I mean, it's actually a correct definition of equivalence, but it's the one which is infinitary, whereas this one is you can write down as without co-induction, it's finitary in a sense. I mean, yeah.
Yeah. Thank you.
Other questions?
I want to take back what I said earlier, because in your initial wrong statement of univalence, you made two changes mm-hmm. compared to the usual statement.
Yes.
And I missed one of them, which made it inconsistent.
Okay.
So that's why I got confused.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But yeah, that statement was inconsistent.
Mm-hmm. Okay, good.
Can you point out the two differences so we also get the subtlety?
Yeah. Okay, yes. Yes, so here I said, okay, where is it? Oh, yeah, here. Yeah. So equivalence, isomorphism appears twice. So I say here is isomorphism and here. Yeah. So I say e to I is a function from equality to isomorphism, and I say it is an isomorphism. Right. And that's not good. It's a very strange axiom, because this is not a proposition. So this axiom is also, in a way, it's a bad principle, because it's not clear which one we chose, right? So, whereas this one, where is it? Univalence. So here, we use equivalence, and here.
Sorry? Mm-hmm.
So both of them are equivalences. Both of them I mentioned equivalence, and this here is a proposition. So that's a good axiom in a way, it's not really an axiom, but it's a good principle because it just states a property. There's no content, there's no choice here. And actually this one is consistent, as we know. I mean, we know it first by Vovotsky giving a classical interpretation using simplicial sets, and then Kokong and his team giving a constructive version using cubical sets.
Okay, but then what happens is halfway around.
Sorry? Can you say again? Hello?
Yes. So, can you hear me?
Yeah, now I can hear you. What was your question? Can you, or your remark?
I was with the connection. I said, let me try again. So if you
sound very robotic, Tamu, you sound very
equivalent.
Well, you can reboot your router. Okay. Not that I recommend. I'm trying to use even two places. Yeah. Oh. I think that what so let me see. So the interesting fact is that logically equivalence and isomorphism are equivalent, logically equivalent. What does this mean? It means I have to think about this. Sorry, I think the mixed combinations are also bad because, for example, let me see. So equality, if you say equality is equivalent to isomorphism, that means also that equality is isomorphic. If you say that equality is equivalent to isomorphism, then that's also bad because that is not, should not be true, I think. But if I say that equality is isomorphic to equivalence, I think Nicola has the answer. Oh yeah.
Sorry, can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Yeah, sorry. I apologize for before. I don't know whether I talked to someone. I had some technical problems. Anyway, so yeah, this is related to why I was confused before. So the statement that you made before that the map which maps identities to isomorphisms is an isomorphism, that is consistent but not good because, that is inconsistent.
Yes.
Yeah. If you have the mixed version where you say that the map from identity to equivalence is an isomorphism, I thought that's what you had, but that's not what you had. So that is consistent, but it's bad because it's not a proposition and you have no chance to recover canonicity from that.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I guess then you can consider saying that the map from identity to isomorphism is an equivalence, but that's
bad. I think that should be bad too, no?
Yeah.
There's a chair. I have to
finds a chair.
Yeah, so I think I also have a quick question then.
Okay, good.
So,
there he is.
So this is an interesting way of removing, for example, this is set constructor.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And from looking at your abstract and also what you plan to talk probably in this section 6.
Yes.
You have other example on how to apply this in other places, for maybe the free group. And
I should have said something about free groups, which I didn't. So if you look at the definition here of the integers, I think it's very natural because it basically says that the integers are the free group over with one generator, which is very natural because we usually think of the natural numbers as a free monoid with one generator. So the question is whether the free group over a set is always a set, and this is something Nikolai and I have worked on, and I think Nikolai knows much more about this. So it turns out we can use this proof which I have sketched here, as long as the set is has a decidable equality, because then you can normalize. But if you don't have a decidable equality, then the normalization doesn't work anymore, and then it's difficult. And we have shown that if you truncate one level higher, a level of groupoids, then you can show that it's always a set. But as far as I know, maybe Nikolai can correct me, the general case is still open, right? I mean, the general question whether the free group over a set is a set, or have you done this? Did I forget something, Nikolai?
I haven't done it, but I think Christian Sattler has a sketch why this is true, uh-huh. but it doesn't work in normal homotopy type theory. It needs two level type theory, so it needs an extension.
Yeah, two levels I would expect, because we're talking about different many levels, right? So, yeah. Sure, okay.
But can this scale to other algebraic structures? This kind of idea of removing, the set truncation and being able to still to get some coherence in some sense.
Yeah, I mean the thing the point I wanted to refer to is the definition of type theory in type theory of hot in hot, where you define it as the initial category with families. And Ambrosch Kaposi and myself, we have done this in the truncated setting, and this is a sort of intrinsic presentation of type theory. But the question is, the truncated setting is also exactly annoying, because you cannot eliminate into something which is not a set. So in particular, you cannot interpret the syntax of type theory in the category of sets, which is like the standard model is lost, which is a very strange thing, right? So really you would like to omit this truncation constructor, but then you have to add lots of coherences. And that's what Nikolai has worked on recently, to show how we can formulate these coherences. But I don't think Nikolai, you haven't yet looked at this if you use this as an inductive definition, right?
I have looked at it, but not successfully.
You haven't done it. Okay, I was correct in the sense of you haven't done it. Okay.
Yeah.
So to formulate a coherent version of higher CWFs, what Nikola has done is to define what is an omega CWF, and then it should be possible to define the intrinsic syntax of type theory as a initial higher CWF, and then you get a very strong elimination principle, and also we should be able to show this. Something else which I think you have looked at but maybe not done yet is, because we haven't got the definition, then the conjecture would be that the initial such a thing should be set, unless you build in something which falls under the set. So that's dissimilar to here. Yeah. So if you build the higher CWF, the syntactic higher CWF, the initial higher CWF, that should be a set without being forced to be a set. Similar to here, the integers with the coherence turn out to be a set without being forced to be a set. So what you get is that actually this initial structure is the same as the set structure, is isomorphic, but you get a much stronger elimination principle.
I think I'm only slowly starting to understand the game here. So let me ask something to see if the picture is correct.
Yeah.
So this is also inspired by what Nicolai wrote in the chat. So are you then generally interested in these situations where, you know, you want to have fairly liberal eliminations? So there are things, and there are the initial things, and on the level of initial things, you often have sort of coincidences, but when you're interested in defining functions out of these initial things, yes, like you need homomorphisms, you really want to be able to go to as many structures as possible. So you yes, you want your definition of a thing of an algebraic structure to be liberal, mm-hmm, but then and then you don't want to code up these things that incidentally are true in the initial structure into exactly the very definition of the structure.
Exactly. Yeah. That's a very good summary. Yeah. Exactly.
Okay.
So I really like this this idea that Tarmo just stated, but I feel like the issue is like, engineering your initial thing to be coherent in the way you want involves a good deal of ingenuity and making some non-deterministic choices of like how you do this, right? But yes, somehow it shouldn't matter because what you're trying to do is just make the initial thing coherent in the way you want without doing so in a way that says like it is a set or it's a proposition or something like that, because that limits where you can map out to.
Yeah, but I think what's going on here is that lots of the definitions we know are working well on the level of sets, but then they may not survive the exposure to higher types. Yeah, and then when we look at higher types, we have to come up with a different for the set truncated word equivalent definition, which does work in the higher setting. And this obviously disquiet, I guess, a good sort of sense of what is a good definition in a higher setting, basically. So I know Christian is somebody who can see very quickly how you formulate something in a way that it works in a higher setting, yeah. So all what we need to do is now to clone Christian, and we are done, basically.
Yeah, I guess that's one strategy. But what I find kind of like unsatisfactory is that there's not a unique way to do this in general.
No, but come on, in mathematics, there's always good taste, right? And good taste is a product of mathematical intuition, which you acquire. And there's no fixed algorithm what is good taste or how you develop good taste, right?
Yeah.
The problem is you may have a good taste for set level mathematics, but now you have to develop a good taste for higher order mathematics, and that is a different ballgame.
Okay, so more questions?
Okay. Then maybe so you can stop recording, Nicolo. Sorry. And then maybe you can send me whatever you got there.